Hey guys, it's Hey Mike here and welcome back to my YouTube channel. So today I'm going to be reacting on the video geography. Now they're talking about Malaysia and how Malaysia became Malaysia, basically. And yeah, the reason why I also got interested into this video is because I'm an international student here in Malaysia. I've been living in Malaysia for like 1 year and a half now, and I've never really learned about the history because I'm starting with the course or the subject of that Bengajian Malaysia next in 2 months. So yeah, let me just give myself a little bit history and see if some of the things they say is true or not based on the things I already know and I've already experienced. And yeah, enough talking, let's just get straight into the video. Let's go.
Well, here we go. Ever since I made the intro, we're like,
okay, now that you did our cousin's episode, do not mess with ours.
Oh, don't worry, Malaysia. And here to reassure you, I made you some nasi goreng.
Nasi goreng. Nasi goreng ayam. Nasi lemak.
Hey everybody, I'm your host Barbs. How refreshing. We are back in Southeast Asia.
This guy looks different in almost every video.
East Timor, Indonesia. We are doing the last country in the Nusantara archipelago, Malaysia. Ahem.
Southeast
sorry,
Asia.
Didn't see you there, Singapore.
That's Indonesia.
You're so small. So what do the Malaysians bring to the table that the others don't? Well, let's find out in the first segment. Cue transition. Now this is going to be really fun because Malaysia's land has so many unique twists and turns, and explaining it, it's kind of like doing a Rubik's Cube blindfolded. Right, Ken?
Right, totally.
Yeah. You got it?
I don't know. Did I?
You got it. First of all, Malaysia is located in Southeast Asia, divided into two main parts. Peninsular Malaysia, where about 40% of the land, which also has the southernmost tip of mainland Asia, Tanjung Piai. While East Malaysia, or Malaysian Borneo, takes about 60% of the country's land on the island of Borneo, making it one of the only two islands shared by three nations, along with Cyprus. If you want to be technical, Cyprus kind of has four, including the UN buffer zone, but you get the point.
Just I never knew that. Episode.
Keep in mind, about 80% of the population lives on the peninsula, while only about 20% live on Malaysian Borneo.
I didn't know it was a Malaysian Borneo.
Off its shores, the state of Sabah having the most.
I mean the peninsula.
The largest one being Bangi Island. However, the island of Sebatik is a little bigger, but the island is split in half with.
Which
Indonesia
means I'm on the
south.
Peninsula
also,
side.
They have a little bit of a dispute with the Philippines in the east. The country is divided into 13 states and 3 federal territories. Putrajaya Labuan, with the capital Kuala Lumpur. However, due to overcrowding, almost all the government ministries and administrative offices were moved to Putrajaya in 1990. After Kuala Lumpur, the next largest cities are Georgetown on Penang Island and Ipoh. The busiest airports are Kuala Lumpur International, Kota Kinabalu, and Penang Internationals. Now here's the thing, Malaysia lies under the South China Sea. If you don't know anything about this place, and if you didn't watch the Brunei episode, it basically goes like this. Basically, every country in this area wants a piece of these things called the Spratly Islands. Today, Malaysia has claim to about 11 of them, and the most notable one being Layang Layang, which they built an airbase on. Now you might notice that it's interesting how these two small entities, Singapore and Brunei, got mixed up into this whole region. Well, when it came to Brunei, it kind of went down like this.
Welcome to the Malaysia Agreement. Sultans, please sign the paper saying you'd like to be part of Malaysia.
Wait, I'd have to give up that? And I'd have to lose control of what? Oh, hell no. As for Singapore, it was...
I thought Singapore was part of That's what I learned. Like, Singapore was part of Malaysia, and then they decided to become their own country. That's what I know. I don't know if I'm right or wrong, but let me just
more see. Like,
hey Malaysia, you just got free from British rule. Let's join up.
Makes sense? Yeah, we are now one country.
Yeah. You have too many Chinese people, and you're gonna waste my money.
I knew
yeah, that. Well, you only get privileges to Malay.
You know what? You're out of the club.
Yeah, fine. You know, whatever. I quit. One day, you know what? I'm gonna make something of myself.
Okay.
And boy howdy, did they keep that promise. Otherwise, some notable places of interest might include places like the largest roundabout in the world, the Petronas Towers, the tallest twin buildings in the world,
attraction.
Kuala Lumpur Tower, the Batu Caves. The Hindu Shrine, the National Monument of Malaysia, Legoland, Malaysia. Yep, they have one. Sunway Lagoon, the National Mosque of Malaysia, Kek Lok Si Buddhist Temple, these palaces, the old Dutch buildings.
So far, it's like I've crossed off all this touring age. Places, Batu Caves, okay, Petronas, who's never been to Petronas, the KL Tower, the National Mosque, and I've been to Ipoh, Langkawi, let's see.
Malacca, the Leaning Tower of Teluk Intan, Afamosa Fortress, the Cat Statue of Kuching,
this
Heritage Museum,
Sarawak
Cultural Villages, and the Sepilak Orangutan Rehabilitation Center. Yeah, orangutans, they have plenty of those in here. Which means we can now swing over to the next segment.
physical.
When it comes to Malaysia's land, they got kind of lucky because not only is it like rich and beautiful, but unlike their neighbors, you don't really have to deal with any crazy catastrophes. First of all, Malaysia rests comfortably on the bottom of the Eurasian plate, literally shielded on all sides, mostly by Indonesia and the Philippines. This means that if any earthquakes occur, Indonesia usually absorbs all of it. If cyclones and tropical storms attack, the Philippines and Indonesia take the hit. And if a volcano erupts, they don't have to worry because they don't really have any volcanoes, and it's probably happening in Indonesia.
Guess we are safe.
Thanks, Indonesia. Now, when it comes to nature, even though the largest lake, the Kenyir Reservoir, lies on the west peninsula of Malaysia side, the eastern Malaysia Borneo side has all the extremes. They have the highest mountain, Mount Kinabalu, the longest river, the Rajang, and a lot more animals. In fact, Malaysia is one of the most biodiverse countries in the world. They have 14,500 species of flowering plants and trees, over 600 bird species, over 200 species of mammals. Speaking of which, peninsular Malaysia is home to the most black panthers in the world. Insert Wakanda joke, I don't have time. Speaking of that, the national animal is the Malaysian tiger, which is also featured on the coat of arms, which we will cover in Flag Friday. Stay tuned. Otherwise, they have elephants, rhinos, orangutans, and they even have their own version of tapirs like the ones in South America. Wow.
Damn.
And that creepy looking proboscis monkey. Many of these species you can find in one of the oldest rainforests in the world, over three times older than the Amazon, Taman Negara. Malaysia is also a land of caves. In fact, they have the largest chamber in the world that can be found in Sarawak. Otherwise, Malaysia is known for producing electronics, palm oil, petroleum, gas, and rubber. They're actually the second largest palm oil producer in the world and the largest condom maker.
What?
They even have their own national car company, Proton, making Malaysia Proton the 11th country in the world with the capability to fully design and engineer and manufacture cars. Otherwise, some national dishes might include things like nasi kandar, nasi dadang, nasi kerabu,
nasi lemak,
mangosteen and durian are treasured fruits, and the national dish, nasi lemak. Oh, and if you have the chance, see if you can witness the famous Tariq tea shows. The servers pour out tea, sometimes over a meter in length. It's almost seen as like an art form. Okay, I think that's just about it for now in this segment. Let's talk about the coolest part of Malaysia, the Malaysians. Just for the record,
so far, like living here for the past 1 year and a half or so, I think I've seen Indians, seen Malaysians, seen, I think, Japanese. I can't differentiate, but I think it's Chinese, Japanese. Yeah, Chinese / Japanese. And a few of us Africans here, but then we're growing in numbers.
The word Malay refers to the races that make up Malaysia. Malayan is the geographic term for peoples of West Malaysia on the peninsula and not part of Borneo.
I didn't know that.
Malaysian is the nationality and citizenship. So a Malay person in Singapore is Malay, but not Malaysian. And a citizen of Indian descent living in Kuala Lumpur would be a Malaysian and Malayan, but not Malay. Got it?
What?
Probably not. First of all, the country has about 32 million people and is one of the fastest growing nations in Asia. The country is made up of 67% Malay or Bumiputera indigenous Malay peoples. We'll talk more about that in a bit. About a quarter of the population is Chinese.
Yeah,
about 7%
Chinese
are Indians, and the rest are other groups mixed in, including a few other Asian groups and Europeans. They use the Malaysian ringgit as their currency. They use the type G and M plug outlets, and they drive on the left side of the road. Now, here's the thing.
Same as Africa.
Politics. No, we're not getting into an ideological debate. We're just going to explain the system in which Malaysia's government operates.
Proceed.
Malaysia is one of the few monarchies in the world. However, it's not a monarchy in the conventional sense because they kind of have nine kings. These nine states each have a royal leader known as a sultan, and every 5 years they rotate to allow one of the nine sultans to rule as head king, known as the Yang Di Pertuan Agong. That means that technically, if you were a boy and your dad just finished being king for his 5-year term, you could be the next one, but you would have to wait at least 40 years for it to happen.
Damn!
Since 8 other kings would have to be king before you. Yeah, I know, it's like, oh, what the? There's a lot more that goes into it, but that's kind of like the basic underlying.
This network is lagging.
I mean, the closest thing would be maybe the Comoros with that rotating president thing, but it's nowhere near as complex as this. Nonetheless, the royals are held under a constitution that limits their power mostly to cultural and religious affairs, as well as appointing certain leaders and so on. Most of the government activity is held and controlled by the prime minister and the parliament. Which brings us to the most recent controversy, the 2018 election. This effectively changed everything, as for the first time since 1957, the BN party was voted out and the new PKR party took over. And it was actually a peaceful transition. We really don't have a lot of time to talk about it, but...
And one thing I've noticed about Malaysia, it's like, everywhere you go, you see the flag. I've never been to a place where there is no Malaysian flag. Unlike my country, you can go for 3 weeks without seeing the flag, unless it's in your home or at school or something, but Malaysia's flags are everywhere.
The that's really interesting to look into, and talk to a Malaysian person if you want to know more about it. It was like a huge deal for the country. Anyway, the country has two official recognized languages, Malay and English. They were once a British territory, so it kind of makes sense. It's taught from elementary school. Malay is basically intelligible to Indonesian. Both countries generally understand each other. I explained this a bit in the Indonesia episode. For Malay, the words are easy to read, but the problem is the intonation. For example, the word for slowly, I believe, is perlahan, not perlahan. It's like you just have to know how these things work. Nonetheless, about half of the population is mostly fluent in three languages, adding their mother tongue, especially if they're part of the Chinese and Indian minority groups. And they are allowed to take vernacular schools that teach in these languages, just like Singapore. Which brings to culture. In Malaysia, the population is quite diverse. You have a lot of Chinese, known as the Peranakan Chinese, that have existed there since the 15th century. They have a unique Chinese-Malay culture with a touch of European influence. The Indian community is mostly Tamil and Telugu-speaking South Dravidian Indian groups that were brought over during the British colonial years. Then, of course, you have the largest people group, ethnic Malays, or the Bumiputera, as well as the really indigenous ethnic Malays that make up the majority of the population in East Malaysia on Borneo. Sometimes these two people groups are collectively joined together under the term Malay, although some might disagree. But either way, these two groups kind of steer the direction in terms of what constitutes Malay culture. Oh, and don't even get started on the Bajau people that live on these structures in the middle of the ocean for their lives, and they've adapted to hold their breath for like 15 minutes underwater. Yeah, those people are cool. Another thing I really want to highlight is that sometimes Indonesians do kind of accuse Malaysians of stealing their culture, because a lot of Malaysians are descended from Sumatra. Faith-wise, Malaysia is also quite diverse. Although the country's official religion is Islam, it's a multi-confessional nation. Buddhists are mostly from the Chinese community, Hindus for the Indians, Christians from all races. Numerous temples, mosques, and shrines and churches are found all over. Malay culture is defined by a number of aspects. For one, the clothing. Remember a couple months ago, that guy from Malaysia, Kamarul, sent me the Malay hat, the Tengkolok? So I forgot to bring this on set when we were filming, but I still have the hat, and I love it, and I told you I would wear it in the episode. So here I am, I'm wearing it in the Malaysia episode. Thank you so much, man. I asked some of you guys, the Malaysian geography peeps, what you would like me to highlight in terms of Malay culture, and some things you said included things like the performing arts joget such dance. As joget dancing and makgyong theater, martial arts, songket weaving, the traditional steep roof and sharp buttress architecture, gamelan music. Speaking of which, history time. We don't have enough time to go too far into it, but in the quickest way I can put it, Hindu kingdoms, Buddhist kingdoms, Islamic Sultanate, Portuguese came in, Dutch came in, British came in, made the White Raja
period. A lot of diversity.
World War II, Japanese came in, British came in again, independence. Okay, very quickly, just to cut, this is the part where I totally forgot to mention all the cool stuff that happened in the 60s. It's how they got those two states in Borneo. We'll explain more on Flag/Fan Friday, so stay tuned. Economic restructuring and industry boom, 2018 vote for the new prime minister, and here we are today. All right, some notable people that you guys, the Malaysian geography, suggested that I should mention in this video might include people like Siti Nurhaliza, Lat, the cartoonist, Sheikh Muzaffar Shukor, P. Ramli, Ziavi, Hang Tua, Enrique of Malacca, Michelle Yeoh, Tony Fernandez, Air Asia owner, designer Jimmy Chu, Melinda Louie, singer Yuna, so far, director James Wan, Dr. Chu. Mahathir Mohamed, Nicole Ann David, Lee Chong Wei, Henry Golding, and first Prime Minister Tunku Abdul Rahman. I'm sure there's way more famous people I could have mentioned, but we gotta move on. Time to go to the last part of this episode.
I think, if I'm not mistaken, I think there's a university named after him, if I'm not mistaken. I don't know, I'm not sure.
Now, Malaysia is quite the powerhouse player when it comes to Southeast Asia. They got a good thing going on, and they host great parties. Outside of Asia, the EU has good relations.
Great parties?
Making Malaysia one of the top three trading partners of Southeast Asia, and specifically Austria loves
pharmaceuticals
with them. Of course, the UK
is maybe still came in the wrong time.
A colony. Much of the cultural residue is still evident to this day. They are one of the Commonwealth of Nations. Many Malaysians live in the UK, and most of the white population in Malaysia are of British descent. As a member of the Association of Southeast Asian Nations, of course, they have close ties to their neighbors. Cambodians love Malaysia and visit often, whereas Malaysia is one of the closest and biggest investors of Cambodia. Thailand has a few issues, since there are those Malay Patani separatists in the south that keep protesting. Whereas the Philippines is like, we're really similar ethnically, but you're mostly Muslim and I'm mostly Catholic, but whatever, we both like coffee and fried chicken. When it comes to their best friends, however, most Malaysians I've talked to have said Indonesia and Singapore. Singapore may have left the Malaysian Union, but they still kept close ties as a sovereign state. They are quite cooperative in business, and even culturally, they are very similar, with noticeable Chinese and Indian minority enclaves. Indonesia is like fight the big brother that has a very different political system, but in the end, they cannot deny how alike they are. True. The biggest difference would be that most Indonesians have a Javanese background, Javanese. Whereas the Malaysians are just Malay, mostly Sumatran, but they talk the same, they eat the same, they enjoy the same hot, humid atmosphere, and they have close relations altogether. In conclusion, with sultans, kings, tigers, panthers, temples, shrines, mosques, and really cool hats, it's no wonder why Malaysia is becoming a hot spot that everyone's talking about today. Stay tuned!
So I guess this is the end of the video. If you guys made it to the end, I hope you liked the video. And I learned a lot about Malaysia, well, at least I'm within Malaysia. And I think I'm going to rewatch this video. Like, I want to visit the parts where I haven't, like, toured yet. And this is a nice country, guys. I won't lie to you. Like, before I came, they had, like, people keep telling me this stigma, racism. There's a lot of racism in Malaysia. There's this and that. People stare at you wherever you go. But then I myself haven't experienced any of that, not even one. I don't know if I'm not black enough, but yeah, maybe I'm lucky, I don't know. But then I haven't experienced any of that, and so far I've enjoyed my time here. And if you guys like live around Kuala Lumpur, Petaling Jaya, just leave a comment. Maybe we might meet up and we might have make new friends, you never know. And if you guys made it to the end of this video, please leave a like, comment, and see you on the next one. Peace.